Good morning, San Bernardino. This is Mayor John Valdivia with another very important update. This is our morning brew with the mayor. And joining us in this segment is our San Bernardino Police Chief, Interim Chief, Eric McBride. Welcome, Chief McBride. How are you?
Good morning. Good to be here.
Well, today we want to highlight the year-end report of 2020 and highlight the good efforts of our San Bernardino Police Department. There's a lot of work to do in the city, and we understand that policing is a very important aspect of city government. Joining us today will be Chief McBride, as I mentioned, and providing a simple review of what occurred and some of the highlights of 2020. So Chief, tell us a little bit about 2020. Obviously, it was a very tough year. We experienced the national pandemic, the worldwide pandemic. In fact, it was of deep concern to us as we attempted to triage all of the resources for our community. But nonetheless, we're here in 2021, and we're excited about 2021 with the new administration at the federal level. We welcome that them to, and certainly looking forward to partner with our national and federal agencies. But tell us a little bit here on the home front, the city of San Bernardino, how are we doing as a police organization? And I'll turn it over to you.
Good morning. Yes, 2020 had been a challenging year with the pandemic. It really affected our policing strategies. Obviously, we had to modify that to protect our responses to crimes, to protect our workforce as well as the community. As you know, police officers can be infected and can infect others. So we had to modify that. So a lot of that went into our responses changed to lower priority crimes. And we'll talk a little bit about that later. We talked about it during the year. But it's been very challenging. A lot of cities have reported across the country, it's a nationwide trend that cities are seeing 10 and sometimes 20 year highs in violent crime, although they're seeing a significant reduction in property crimes. And we're no different. We're following that national trend, despite the fact that we have seen a huge increase in our handgun arrests in the city. And we've arrested and seized several hundred more guns this year off the streets than previous years. And then another interesting thing is that we're seeing, because of the pandemic, we're seeing what zero bail and some other crime reform programs that people looked at in the past that have kind of been implemented this year because of COVID, where we're seeing a reduction in prison population because of COVID. So they're releasing people early out on the streets. They experimented with zero bail during the year. And then, and so we're seeing an increase in a lot of those crimes that we think are directly related to those early releases.
Let me stop you right there, Chief. Talk a little bit about the zero bail. That's something new that occurred in 2020 as we kind of were worried, more concerned about the national pandemic and the spread of COVID and the resources to combat that. Public health was of critical concern for 2020. And as mayor of the city, we wanted to certainly focus in on public health in coordination with our county public health department, as well as the governor's orders. But tell us a little bit about, sometimes we miss the headline, and tell us a little bit about the zero bail. Can you unpack that a little bit more?
Sure. So it's been bantered around a little bit by a lot of people in the state and around the country about zero bail. And it's essentially that a cash bail where you have to post money to be bailed out. And then instead of that, it goes towards what your record is. So California, because it wanted to reduce both the jail and prison populations due to COVID, did institute a form of zero bail during the year, early part of the pandemic. And that would be essentially that for many offenses, people were released after they were booked and didn't have to stay in jail. They didn't have to post bail. So a lot of people got out with little recourse. And then because the courts were closed for a while, there's a huge backlog. So a lot of these individuals were still out on the street, even though they've been arrested and charged potentially with cases, or because they're released, it's still waiting to be charged. And what we're hearing is that a lot of those people out there that they don't feel like there's very many consequences for their actions because they're not staying in jail. So essentially, if someone gets arrested and say for a gun offense and they don't have any serious priors, and it's a felony, maybe they're a felon or maybe it's a stolen gun, they would be released the next day or that same day without having to post any bail.
Well, that gives us a little background as to what our police officers have to deal with as they patrol our streets. Tell us a little bit about the police officers. How many sworn, unsworn, and how many employees in the police department? Walk us through some of the employees, those number counts.
We're authorized 268 sworn police officers. Some of those are general fund, and then we've been very successful at obtaining grants. So we picked up about 14, 15 positions at least minimum that are grant funded that brought that total up. And then we're looking at about 150-ish, maybe a little bit less in professional staff, which are the support people, the criminal investigation officers, the dispatchers, the records clerks, the community service officers. So altogether, just under 500 employees in the police department that are out there working to make the city safe. Now, we have had some challenges because of COVID in recruitment, but we've been plugging along as we've been getting those extra positions that are grant funded. We've been hiring people as quickly as we can. Of course,
let's talk about grant funding, because grant funding is really those federal and state dollars that we can pull down from those federal agencies. Just this past year, again, during COVID, some of the headlines were missed for our community. It's the first time in several years that we received a COPS justice, federal justice grant. Talk us through that, and what does that allow for?
Yeah, so that allows for 13 police officer positions that we're gonna get funded through the Department of Justice for 3 years. And typically there's a matching requirement, but we wrote the grant to request the waiver of the matching funds. So we're essentially getting 13 police officers paid for by the federal government in our city without any requirement for matching funds. We've also got a grant that's gonna be coming for the city council for approval pretty quick to fund four positions in the police department being paid for by San Manuel. We just obtained a tobacco grant to do tobacco enforcement in the city. That's gonna fund another police officer position along with a criminal investigation officer and a community engagement officer. And then also Dignity Health funds a couple of police officers in the city as well that staff the emergency rooms in the city's hospitals.
So, also, let's not forget the railroad grant in August of 2020. We received about $100,000 to integrate safety operations with BNSF police. Tell us a little bit about what that initiative is all about.
So there's a lot of issues with safety. There's a lot of, as people know, there is a significant transient population. A lot of them camp out or are around the rail yards or the railroad lines. And we have some of the biggest rail lines in San Bernardino. We have a lot of rail here in the city, as everybody is well aware. And so there's an asset to protect people at the railroad crossings, as well as prevent people from walking on the tracks. And also there's sometimes when the trains stick around on the tracks a bit longer, sometimes there's some theft issues taking place. So this is to ensure the safety around the tracks in the city at the railroad crossings and along the railway, and then also to protect it against theft as well.
So that includes traffic enforcement. We want to remind our residents, obviously, and pedestrians, those rail crossings are critical because the safety measures, now we're on the southerly portion. I know when I was a councilman, I was advocating for the no noise zone areas, and we were successful in that. So we want to caution you folks, and certainly the children and pedestrians nearing the railroad intersections and the crossings, to be very careful and aware as you cross and traverse the rail lines. Also, one thing that I think is important and missed is some of the cargo theft and the vandalism that goes along with the rail lines. Can you maybe help us understand that additional component of the grant?
Yes, there's, as you mentioned, and I mentioned earlier, there is sometimes theft that takes place. Sometimes the trains have to sit on the tracks for a little longer outside the rail hub, and that makes an opportunity for people to break into those. And there's all kinds of cargo that are on those trains. People have to remember that the cargo comes into the ports, whether it's the Long Beach or Los Angeles, gets loaded on trucks, and those trucks are brought to San Bernardino, where those trailers, those containers are then loaded on the railhead to go across the country. So there's all kinds of merchandise, you name it, it's on those trains. And it's sometimes sitting there, and these trains are, as many of us know, sometimes very, very long, and the conductor or the person on that train can't watch all of them at once. So it's important for us to support them on that, to protect that.
My understanding is the mounted unit, we have a mounted unit team in our city. They were integrating with our overall policing of those rail lines. How many members in our mounted unit do we have in our city?
It fluctuates. I think it's anywhere from 4 to 6 right now. And they provide their own horses and they go out there and patrol the railway. As you know, it's oftentimes not it's not conducive to walking a long distance, and the horses can go a greater distance than a person can on foot, but it also places them up at a higher position to see over obstacles and in bushes and stuff like that. So it actually works really, really well having those horses down there patrolling that railway too.
Okay, now just recently you provided an update to the San Bernardino City Council regarding some of the statistics. Let's walk through an abbreviated portion of that. For more information, I'm going to point to our screen, and we will have a lot of those links and information available so you can actually hear the video of our police chief during the city council presentation. Okay, Chief McBride, walk us through a portion of this crime statistics for 2020.
Sure, I'll talk about part one crimes, which is really the crimes that people look at. And it includes murder, rape, robbery, and some property crimes. So, and I'll talk about 2020 and compare it against 2019. So homicides were up following a national trend across the country. We went from 44 to 69 homicides. Rape is down by one, from 134 to 133. Robbery went down from 825 in 2019 to 726. Aggravated assaults are up, following the trend with homicides, from 1,622 to 2,054. And then you see the big drop-offs. You see burglaries went from nearly 2,000 to 1,100. Thefts from almost 4,500 to 3,000. Grand Theft Auto is down by 100, almost 200. And so overall, when you look at it, violent crime was up by 13%, from 2,625 individual incidents to 2,982, but property crime went from 8,279 to 5,970, for a drop of 27%. So overall, when you look at the overall crime is down almost 18%. Now you do see those spikes in violent crime and the aggravated assault and homicides, but overall, pretty much everything is down across the board.
So these are part one crimes.
Correct.
As described by our police chief, we want to make sure that we emphasize safety for our community. Our San Bernardino Police Department has the commitment from this mayor and our city council to continue efforts to abate and intervene and have those proactive enforcements. Tell us a little bit about the next phase of the presentation that you gave to the council.
So the next phase is we'll talk about you know, our challenges, of course. We really started to see the spike in violent crime in March, which coincides with the COVID-19 lockdowns. And there's a lot of criminologists that are pointing to the anxiety and the fact that people are living in closer proximity because they're not going to work and they're not leaving the home. And that's leading to a lot of the violent crime increases. In fact, I think nearly 30 of our, or just under 30 of our homicides, the incident leading up to the homicide was a disagreement. So we're seeing a lot of crimes or violent crime that we didn't see in the past. Typically, we would see a lot of gang-on-gang crime, but now, and motivated by the gang. But what we're seeing now is, while someone may be a gang member, it doesn't mean that necessarily the crime was gang-motivated. And so we've seen a big change in that, and that's very similar across the country. We're also seeing the early prison releases that are affecting us. In November, when we looked at homicides, we're just around the low 60s. At least 20 of the either victims or suspects have been released from prison early. And so these are people that should have been locked up still, should have been in custody. But because of COVID and because of a lot of other things, the reduction, the push to reduce the prison population right now, people are released early and they're out on the streets. And so these are people that would have been somewhere else and not in the city of San Bernardino. And we think that is also leading to a increase and our violent crime. So some of the policy decisions that are being made outside of our city here are affecting us here. Our police department goes out, we do our job, The police officers are arresting more people than they have ever before, more people for violent crime, more people for gun possession, illegal gun possession charges. And so they're doing everything they can, but we're seeing a breakdown elsewhere in the system, and that's in the courts, I think, and in the state criminal justice system.
Well, and I think you make a very important point. Sometimes the residents clearly have one thought in mind, and I think sometimes we need to take a step back and see some of those policy decision legislature moves from our state capitol. They are at times, I scratch my head, I'll tell you. And residents, you need to call your state assemblyman and voice your concerns. As legislation is being made outside of this city, sometimes our hands as policymakers at the local level are tied. All right, let's move on to the next phase of the presentation and kind of bring this back home.
Sure, so we talked about homicides a little bit, but let's talk about traffic fatalities. So traffic fatalities, we always have our fair share of those, but this year we did see an increase in traffic fatalities, a significant increase. In fact, we went from 48 in 2019 to 62 this year. And so you say, what are we doing about that, right? So in 2019, we saw 257 DUI arrests. And this year alone, we more than doubled that to 564 in response to what we're seeing out there. And what we're seeing, a far higher percentage of our fatal traffic accidents with people under the influence. And so typically and historically, you would look at alcohol being that, you know, that factor that is people under the influence. But what we see now is that marijuana is almost as significant of an influencer on fatal traffic collisions as our alcohol. So again,
why don't we clear things up, Chief? Because I think sometimes it's assumed that just because cannabis is allowed in the state of California, walk us through. I know that Sergeant Harvey just recently did a quick posting on Facebook on impairment with cannabis. Talk us through some of those concerns that you might have, and what are the safety precautions, and what does the law say as far as an individual consuming and using marijuana, and then now taking and using the road?
And with any legal substance, you know, alcohol is legal, cannabis now is legal in the state of California, it's important for people to use those responsibly, whether it's alcohol or marijuana. There is a thing with a lot of people who think that marijuana doesn't affect them as much as maybe alcohol would, and that they would still go out there and drive. But anybody that has ingested marijuana or alcohol needs to act responsibly and not drive if they've been ingesting it or drinking alcohol for that instance. And so what we're also seeing is an increase in people using inhalants as well. And so those are people using canisters of aerosol, and they breathe that in. In fact, we've seen several traffic fatalities where the individual still had the can in their hand behind the wheel of the car. And what it does is they inhale that inhalant, and it causes them to pass out and they crash. We've seen several traffic fatalities under that circumstance.
What's the plan ahead? Thank you for the report on the traffic fatalities, but how do we as a city prepare for the road ahead? I know that there's been talk about, I know I've expressed my concerns about increasing the number of our traffic unit. Tell us a little bit about the plan and the road ahead as we seek other federal grants and state grants. And how do we improve or decrease, I should say, how do we decrease these fatalities related to traffic?
So it real briefly touched on grants. We did receive in total last year about $10 million in grants, which I think is at least in recent memory a record in the number of grants that we received to fund different programs. That being said, of course, we always want to fully staff patrol. Those are the officers that go out there and respond to the calls for service when you call the police department. But we also want to increase our staffing in our proactive units, one of those being traffic. Right now, we have a very minimal amount of officers in that unit, but we want to double it in size. But that requires us to get new officers through training. It takes quite a while. several months to get someone through the background and application process. There's a 6-month long police academy and then about a 5-month field training program. So once we hire somebody, it takes quite a while to get them in the field. But we, with that being said, we want to double our traffic unit. That'll cut down on our traffic fatalities, hopefully, when you see a lot more officers doing traffic enforcement. That being said, we're not resting on traffic enforcement. We've more than doubled our DUI arrests last year over 2019. But we're also going to put more officers in our narcotics unit, our vice unit, our gang unit, and so on. So we want to go out there. We're a very aggressive agency in fighting crime. We make a lot of arrests, and the officers are out there doing a great job.
Okay, let's transition and talk a little bit about community policing. Chief, in 2018 through the 2019 season, as I assumed the mayor's chair here and responsibility for providing the inspiration and motivation to our city council, I learned very quickly that community policing is a great opportunity to revamp a department. Talk a little bit about community policing. Where are we? What are we doing? And what's planned for the future as it regards to community policing and the impacts for our public?
So in 2019, the police department reinstituted community policing. We had not had that form of policing for several years prior to 2019. And we essentially pulled all of our resources back into the police department. And we had one team that would go out and serve the needs of the community. And that was a team of about 4 officers and a sergeant. And they pretty much spent their time in 1 or 2 areas of the city. It really depended on who knew who to get those resources. And we thought that that wasn't the way that, you know, equitable policing is done. So, you know, we instituted community policing in the city, divided back into 5 district commands, each having their own 2 officers and a sergeant assigned to deal with local issues in those districts. And so we went from a handful of officers to 10 officers across the city to do those, respond to chronic crime problems, chronic service drains, whether it's a transient problem or just runs the gamut. And each person in their district knows who to call, and they have those officers available to them as a resource to handle those issues. Really, when you get out there and engage the community gets to know you. They're more cooperative when crime happens, because really, the community is the eyes and ears of the police department. We need everybody working with the police department to help solve crime and make our community better. And community policing is the way to do that. And with that, we've gone out there and had a huge increase in the number of community meetings. Of course, COVID's kind of put a damper on all of those. We found, you know, interesting and unique ways to still outreach to the community, whether it's through Zoom meetings and doing things virtually, but we're still getting those done. And it's building that bridge from the community to the police department. And with that, we think it's really important to get out of the police station. You know, we closed up all of our community policing offices years ago.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about the upcoming community policing substation. We're grateful for the partnership of Inland Center Mall. They have come to the table and made a commitment to our city in almost $300,000 worth of tenant improvements. It'll be located on the southerly portion of the city at Inland Center Mall. Chief, tell us a little bit about what residents and business members can expect from a community police substation. It's a newly created substation. It will come online very soon. So tell us a little bit about this new substation.
So yes, this community substation will be opening here in the next couple months. The Inland Center Mall has been very generous in funding the entire tenant improvements and getting that thing up and running. And so we'll be staffing the district resource officers down there along with the district staff. And eventually someday we'll staff it with the community service officer. And what that does is it provides an opportunity for officers to stay in their district. Right now, when officers have to respond down to the station, it takes them out of service. It takes them out of that district for a significant amount of time. And they'll just go down to that district resource offices to take care of administrative tasks and some other things, and then get right back in service and serve that community. And eventually, when we get it staffed with the community service officer, a lot of things that people typically come down to the police station for downtown, they can go to the community service office, policing office in their district. And as we know, a lot of people just don't have the same means and ability to get downtown. And this allows them to save that commute time downtown, go into the community policing office, handle whether it's getting a report made or providing information to the police department or asking questions about what the police department's doing. And we'll also be able to host community meetings in those offices and stuff like that. So it's a great way to re-engage the community out there where the folks are out there in the community. And we're looking to expand that program over the next couple of years. I think it's a great program. And I think for years we had community policing offices and it was a great asset to the community.
All right, as we bring this segment home of Morning Brew, we wanna say thank you very much to our San Bernardino Police Department headed up by Eric McBride. We're very grateful for Chief McBride and his leadership. And we wanna say thank you very much to all of our patrolmen who are out there patrolling our street. We're very supportive of it. I enjoy getting out in a patrol car as a mayor. I need to do it a little more often, but we're excited for our patrols and really the revamping of our police department. Thank you to the men and women who serve in the non-patrol areas of our city, but have a very important administrative function of our police department. And so we thank them, all the employees there at the police department. And so what final words do you have to our community? Give us some hope and confidence as we entertain 2021. We have some exciting days ahead of us. We'll end with you, Chief McBride.
Thank you. You know, the police department's excited to go out there and serve the community every day. We're recruiting more and more young officers. They're very energetic. They're excited to get out there. They fully have bought into the community policing modeling that we have done. And so when you're out there and you see them, say hi, have that positive interaction with our police department. They're looking for that. They're being encouraged to return that. And so we're looking forward to moving forward in 2021. It's an exciting time. Hopefully we'll see the end of COVID and we'll be able to reinstitute a lot of things that we did in 2019 that we had to kind of go on the wayside in 2020, but we're excited. And the police department is excited to go out there and serve the community every day.
Thank you for joining us today and for another segment of Morning Brew with Mayor Valdivia. Joining us was our police department, our chief, interim chief, McBride. Thank you all for watching this segment of Morning Brew.